In less than an hour or two, the gates at Flemington Racecourse will swing open, welcoming crowds back to the Melbourne Cup for the first time in two long years. Today, Melbourne reporter Christina Hearn has been patiently waiting. Chris, the final checks are done, the sun is out, it is go time.
That's right, Carla. Top of 30 degrees, can you believe, forecast today, and Flemington is looking fine. What a difference a year makes. Standing right here last year, not one racegoer was allowed through these gates. Today, 10,000 fully vaccinated racegoers will be allowed inside. Now, that's nowhere near capacity, of course, but it is a real signpost to the rest of the world that Melbourne is back in business. Inside, the crowd will be separated into colour-coded zones. In fact, I just got a text message saying that the zones inside are now active. The much-hyped birdcage, of course, is gone. It is replaced by a wildflower precinct outside with luxe pods available for celebrities. So it still sounds pretty good to me. Of course, everybody is just happy that some fans will be allowed back into Flemington today. I do have some news from the VRC this morning. I've been speaking to them in the last half hour. Of course, we've been telling you about two horses, Delphi and Future Score. They had to undergo vet checks this morning. They have passed, so they will be lining up in the $8 million race. Of course, all the money, all the talk is about incentivise. The shortest priced favourite since Farlap back in 1930, attempting to become the first horse in 20 years to win the Caulfield Melbourne Cup double. It is, of course, not just about Flemington. Of course, there's going to be parties held right around the city, and I'm going to sniff out some champagne parties in the next hour. Carl?
If anyone can do it, it's you, Chris. Look forward to seeing that. Well, Sydney, meantime, is also set for a bumper Melbourne Cup day with capacity expanded at Royal Randwick. 7,000 last-minute tickets have been released, allowing for 17,000 people to be trackside for the big race. It will be a major boost for the economy and hospitality industry as well, with many venues already booked out.
Prime Minister Scott Morrison has issued a blistering response to the French president after Emmanuel Macron accused him of lying. Nine's Europe correspondent Brett McLeod is following the story from the climate summit in Glasgow. Brett, what did the PM have to say?
Well, Ali, even as he arrived here for the climate summit, he had to deal with the intensifying climate between him and Emmanuel Macron after the French Prime Minister called him a liar. And the Prime Minister today was saying that, in fact, the French was somewhat misleading. He says they knew months in advance that the August treaty was a possibility, that Australia was looking at scrapping its submarine deal with France. And he went on to say that it wasn't just him who was insulted by the French president's comments.
I'm not going to cop sledging at Australia. He was clearly aware over some months that there were concerns, and they were responding to those concerns. And we had correspondence and other messaging during the course of that period. And we decided, in Australia's interests, not to go ahead with the contract. That is what has occurred here.
Yeah, this one isn't going away for a while, is it? And Brett, the Queen, she had a strong message for leaders at the summit.
Yes, this is the recorded message. She had to record because she was told by doctors to stay in Windsor Castle and not come here because of health issues. But she did have a strong and personal message where she mentioned her husband, Prince Philip, several times. But she told leaders that, in a way, echoing Greta Thunberg, no longer necessary just to do talking. It's time to start taking action.
I, for one, hope that this conference will be one of those rare occasions where everyone will have the chance to rise above the politics of the moment and achieve true statesmanship.
And even though it was virtual, many people happy to see the Queen's presence here in Glasgow, Ali.
Yeah, it was lovely to see it looking so well too in that message. Thank you, Brett.
Queensland's health system is being pushed to the limit, with thousands of frontline workers suspended for missing the COVID jab deadline. Today's Jessica Millwood is in Brisbane. Jess, good morning to you. What impact will this have on the state's hospitals?
Good morning, Alex. The Health Minister says there will be disruptions, but she does insist that the health system can cope with some 4,000 frontline workers being stood down. Currently, they're on full pay, but they need to explain why they haven't had a double dose of the vaccine. The deadline for that was yesterday. What we don't know is exactly where these staff are located. And Professor Peter Collignon says that is something we need to know in order to understand how this will impact on our already struggling hospitals.
Well, it is likely to have an impact because I think they've just got over about 100,000 workers. So this represents 3 or 4% of their workforce. And it may not be evenly spread. If it's, for instance, much more of an issue in the regional areas, that's more of a problem.
Our hospitals will face increased pressure when our domestic borders reopen on December 17. And new figures out this morning reveal 1 million Queenslanders won't be vaccinated when that happens, with just 11 local government areas set to reach that 80% vaccination target. Alex.
OK, Jess, thank you. And this just into the newsroom, world number one Novak Djokovic has finally addressed speculation that he won't play in next year's Australian Open. Djokovic says a group of players are waiting for official instruction from Tennis Australia.
I don't want to be part of the stories about the assumptions and what ifs when the official condition requirements to travel to Australia and play in Australia are out, then obviously, I'll see what I personally do with that.
He'll see. OK, Djokovic has dodged questions about his vaccination status all season. We simply still don't know if he's vaccinated or not. Let's check your sport right now on the Melbourne Cup day. It is finally upon us, folks. And if you don't have time to do hours of study on where to place your bets, fear not. TAB bookie Glenn Munsey joins us right now from Padstow in Sydney. Glenn, good morning to you. Thank you so much for being with us. Give him a round of applause. Why not? The man himself. Hey, Glenn, incentivise the raging favourite. It started at $2.30. I just had a look. Where's it at now?
He's at $2.80. Well, first of all, good morning, everybody, on this Melbourne Cup day. Yes, incentivised, looking to be... Well, he is the shortest price favourite since Farlap in 1930. I can guarantee you I wasn't there the day that Farlap started that short. But he's a $2.80 chance at the moment. He's looking for 10 wins in a row. And who would have thought back in April he was getting beat at Toowoomba and then he won a maiden at the Sunshine Coast, which, incidentally, is the same track that Winx began an unbeaten streak late in her career.
Oh, trained by a very prominent trainer in Chris Waller. He's got a few horses in there. I reckon Very Elegant's a bit of a chance. What do you think?
Yeah, well, she ran in the Cup last year. There's about a handful of horses that ran in the Cup last year behind Twilight Payment, including Twilight Payment, who'll be the oldest horse to ever win the Melbourne Cup. If he wins today, he's a 9-year-old, but Very Elegant. He's got James McDonald in the saddle. He rode 4 winners on Derby Day at Flemington, so he's certainly in form. And Chris Waller, no one trains more winners in Australia than Chris Waller.
Any others you like the look of?
Well, you have a look at the different horses in the race here. You look at numbers high up there. Spanish Mission, one of the only two imported gallopers to go around. We're light on for imported gallopers this year. And down the bottom, numbers 21 and 22, Charlie Rose and Floating Artist. T.O. Nugent rides Floating Artist, his first ride in the Melbourne Cup. And Rachel King, she rides Pondus. She's looking to, emulate Michelle Payne by being a female rider to win the Melbourne Cup this year. Now, the most important thing, the Melbourne Cup jumps at 3 o'clock. Don't be waiting till 3 o'clock to have your bet. The tabs here in New South Wales have been open since 7:30, the same in Victoria. They're not far off opening in Queensland. They're opened in Tasmania, South Australia, not too long in the Northern Territory. But if you download the TAB app to your mobile phone, in seconds you can have an account with TAB and you can bet in the luxury of your lounge room or no matter where you are. And if you've got to pick the kids up at 3 o'clock, you can sit in the car just that little bit longer and watch the Melbourne Cup on your phone after having had a bet with TAB.
There you go.
It's like Ali's parenting show.
Just sit and gamble in your car.
Yes. Very good.
Kids are fine. First of all,
I love it.
Kids are resilient.
Thank you so much for being with us. And if I've got a tip for anyone out there, it's be good to your mum.
Yeah.